Are we at the appointed holy time? Okay. Hi, everyone. Man, we've like doubled in size since last week. Wow, and there's Alan Pogue. It's good to see you. Don't dispute anything I say today. Sorry, you all had to witness that little drug deal up here, but I think we're good now. So, well, welcome everyone. I'm Mark Hodges. You're stuck with me for another 2 weeks after this. Really, probably 1 week, because most of you will be out of town the week after Thanksgiving. I get it. So, I want to welcome you back. Today, we're going to cover some things specific to social media, and we're going to hit it running fairly quickly. Each week, I'm going to try and give you a few things that might be helpful to you. And so today, I'm going to start that off by giving you an application. Now, this is probably for some of the younger crowd or some, well, that's not necessarily true. Probably for some of us who are experiencing different changes in life. This application for my phone has changed my life. Okay, and I'm not saying that lightly. It has changed my life. It is free. And you will see that it's got a catchy little name here. If you have not ever used this app, you need to. And let me describe for you what it does. Is anyone familiar with this? Okay, all right. We got a couple of folks here clued in on it. So this app will change your life because if you download it, when you open it up, it will list every movie that is on in theaters right now. You choose the movie, and it will give you the recommended times if you have to take a bathroom break when you can leave that movie. It will give you the line of dialogue that will occur right before the optimal break time is. And it has a handy little timer you can start at the beginning of the movie, so it'll buzz you when it's that time, okay? So it gives you a recommended time, a couple of backup times. Now, some of you are looking at me like, really? Just trust me, okay? This will change your life. Now, it is free. The only thing you've got to do is you've got to sit through about a 10-second, believe it or not, advertisement for a drug for bladder control. And I'm not making that up, okay? That's for real. But that is why it is free, and it is just fantastic. Now, I'm going to dive in today. I had a few things that I was going to show, and then I thought, no, I'm cutting them out. I was up there changing this as you were coming in this morning. I'm going to jump right into social media, and I want to make sure that you understand some of the things I'm going to say today are not what you're going to expect me to say. For some reason, most people, when I get asked to go speak places, they ask me to come talk about social media, like I'm some expert in it. I'm not entirely sure why. I work with all those social media companies. I know a lot of the folks there. I know what their goals are. I know what they're trying to do. I know how things work. I know a lot of the research behind them. But as far as being an expert on it, not so much. I'm the guy who, when my kids were coming of age and were begging me for cell phones, when I finally did cave in and provide a phone for them, I had them sign a user agreement. I wrote up a user agreement that basically said something along the lines of, you agree to be monitored. I will monitor anything and everything that you do, and you're subject to that monitoring, which if you work in any legitimate company across the U.S., you usually have to click through a screen that says, I realize by using this network I'm subject to monitoring and blah, 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 right? Most of you are familiar with that. So I had my kids sign a user agreement. It was pretty hilarious because I'm having them sign a contract with me. I know that some parents live under this, I don't know how to say it other than this fruitless notion of, well, but they should have a right to privacy. No. Not quite so much. They get a right to privacy when they turn 18 or when I stop paying. And so that was kind of my rule of thumb. So the reality was they agreed to that, and then I promptly took those phones and I hacked into them and I reprogrammed them so that every tweet, every text they sent or received, everything got written out to a little Gmail folder that I could go look at it any time, because I like to be somewhat Reagan-esque about this, okay? I trust, but I verify. And so that was my way of making sure that they knew, hey, you can do what you want on it, but I can see it. So just get ready. I think I looked at that folder maybe three times. And I didn't really have a lot of reason to, but I'm the guy who did a lot of that. And so I focus in on social media in a lot of places that I go. And so what I want to do is I want to show you a little bit about how prolific it really has gotten. Now, I tend to look for the absurdities in life when I travel. I do travel a fairly good amount. I don't see Kelly Joyner near as much as I would like to, but I just saw him now, and so my heart is warm. Thank you, Kelly. But I go to the Northeast a lot. I'm usually on one of the coasts, and New York City is one of my stomping grounds. And you know, I'm a little bit of a snob, you know, up there. I like staying in Times Square, but the food in Times Square is just horrific. And you know, I'm going and hunting for places outside of there because it's way too touristy. And so one of the things that I do is I ride the subways a lot because it's a lot faster, it's easier, it's cheaper, it's just great. Well, oftentimes I will go into 42nd Street Station and I will have to walk underground over to the Port Authority. And if you've been up there, you know what I'm talking about. There is this very long concourse that runs underground that will take you between the two. And so in looking for absurdities of life, I'm greeted with them commonly underground in New York City. And one of the ones that stood out to me that I thought I would share with you came to being when the James Bond film Skyfall was coming out. This has been a few years back. Do you remember that film? It was the third of the Daniel Craig trilogy, probably one of the best Bonds that there's ever been outside of Sean Connery and the other guy who you can't name, but it was only in one movie. Well, as I'm walking through that long concourse, I see this poor product placement, because this was also the time when Steven Spielberg's Lincoln movie was coming out. Now, I'm going to give you a second to look at this, because obviously some of you are still asleep. You don't see the absurdity in this, but it is fairly hilarious. So while I'm in the city, one of the clients that I've dealt with for years has been Viacom. I deal with all their networks. I'm the oldest guy in the building, it feels like. Okay, I'm riding the elevators with all these people who are working for MTV and VH1 and all them. They're all hip and they've got their, you know, dark wash skinny jeans on. And you know, I'm a 1968 model. Okay, this was not designed for skinny jeans. So I'll just go ahead and tell you that. So as I'm feeling old, I'm riding up the elevators, going to meetings, and one of the meetings we had one day was on the 48th floor, but we were on 49. We thought, hey, let's just walk down the steps, and we'll just go that way. We'll feel healthy. I'll count steps. It'll, you know, I'll feel good about myself. I get into the stairwell, and I see this. I am not kidding you. This is a real sign from the Viacom building. We're at the point in our social media lives where we're having to tell people, if the building's on fire, leave before you tweet about it. Now, that's pretty sad, but it is a reality, and it's something that is happening all the time. So as we walk through today, I want you to understand that this is affecting everything. One of the things that it affected, and I worked on a project back in 2014-ish, for a company that manufactures chewing gum. Now, you probably don't think too much about companies that make chewing gum. You know, it's an afterthought, but they were having this big problem, still are. Apparently, chewing gum sales in the U.S. is on a dramatic decline, okay? And they were concerned about this, obviously. And chewing gum has changed its life, right? I mean, long gone are the days when I would ask my grandparents for a stick of gum, and they hand me, do you know what they handed me? You got a Juicy Fruit. Who on this planet thought that was a good chewing gum? I mean, honestly, that was the grandmother gum. She would always say, you want some Juicy Fruit? Well, not really, but I guess if I don't want this stink breath, I got to have it, you know. And just, it's a different flavor of stink as far as I'm concerned. So one of the things that has happened with chewing gum is now it's become kind of cosmetic. You know, it comes in these nice little pouches and you have multiple layers to unwrap, and it's almost cosmetic gum, you know. Now it's a challenge, you know. Hey, you want a stick of gum? Yeah, let me show you the container mine came in. I mean, it's a big thing to show off. Well, as we're working through this, we cannot figure out why chewing gum sales are on the decline. And I had a notion hit me. It was Christmas of 2014. I was standing in line at the grocery store. And it hit me what one of the problems is. And I took a picture of it, and we went back, and then we started changing the research we were doing based on that. And that is this picture, which is kind of hard to see, but maybe you can tell. What is everybody in line at the grocery store doing? They're giving it this. Where do you buy chewing gum at the grocery store? In the checkout line. So we have moved from a period where used to be we were fighting our kids saying, hey, quit, you know, put that back, and oh yeah, I gotta get some gum. We've moved from that now to, oh, is it my time to pay? Have you rung it? Okay, well, I'll just swipe the card. We're halfway paying attention most of the time. And this is pretty easy to see. It is hilarious to me to watch men go shopping for clothes with their wives. Because you know what happens. All of a sudden, they are getting very important emails. Because they're all walking around the store while their wives are trying on clothes, and they're doing this. Oh, this is critical. This is important. They don't care about shopping for clothes, but they're thinking, oh, you know, she's got to love me because I'm with her, but I'm going to do this. I mean, let's face it, we all do it. Well, not all. Most of us do it. It is this new reflex that we have. If we find ourselves with more than 5 seconds of empty time, we're grabbing a device and we're looking at it, and most of the time we're looking at social media. So one of the things that I want to do is give you some ideas around social media. I'm going to split this into two parts today. I want to talk about social media, some things that you've got to be aware of, and then I also want to talk about what's happening to our friendships and the effects of those friendships from in a current day model. So let's start with just some things to keep in mind about social media. Now, these are based on my own study, some of the things that I have read. I see a lot of the research that comes across Facebook and Twitter, not the kind that get posted in a timeline, you know, that people take as real news or fact. I mean, when I sit down with these companies and they say, here's some research that we've had commissioned, take a look at this. It's very interesting stuff, but in general, I want you to understand what this is. Except for rare circumstances, you are basically a content generator for an ad platform. Now, you think about that for a second. Facebook has a beautiful business model now. They really do. And if you looked at Wall Street Journal 2 weeks ago, you'll see they reported record earnings, blowing the doors off what Wall Street thought that they were going to do, and it was all driven by mobile advertising, primarily. Facebook is this ingenious thing because they, unlike television or unlike any other type of entertainment outlet, they don't have to create content. You create it for them. Congratulations. And you're not getting paid for it either. Okay? You create the content. You are the reason that eyeballs go to the screen, and all they do is create the infrastructure and sit back and enjoy it and count the money. So let's be clear about where we sit in this whole hierarchy, okay? You are a content generator for an advertising platform. So now, second thing, it is free, so stop claiming ownership. Usually about 3 times a year, you will see a post pop up on timelines, for those of you who are on Facebook. I don't know the exact words, but it goes something like this. I'm not sure if this is real or not, but so-and-so saw it on Channel 5 News, better safe than sorry, so I hereby revoke or, you know, do not allow Facebook to have access to this and this and this and this, and you try and post some legal claim to your posts, your pictures, and everything else on Facebook. Let me be very clear. That if I had an idiot stamp, I would stamp everyone's Facebook page idiot that posts that post because, number one, it's not real. Number two, you cannot make a legal notice like that because you have done something else that supersedes it. You have signed, or as we call click to sign or click through, and approved an EULA, an end user license agreement, when you decided you were going to use Facebook. And guess what that said? It said, yeah, we got a privacy policy, but all the stuff you put out here, you agree you're sharing it. And they may change that privacy policy. And just you posting something on your timeline doesn't mean, oh, Facebook's got this whole area where they're looking at all the people who posted that and said, oh, well, wait, they posted, they made that post, so let's put them off in this other group because we can't use their stuff. The reality, folks, is that is insane to even think. So you need to understand, when you put it out there, you need to release a little bit of ownership because it's free. What did you expect? I mean, at the end of the day, it is free. So, and one of the big things that I'm seeing is relationships are being completely redefined. We're going to talk about that, especially in the second half of this morning, but let me show you a few examples of that. In 2014, one-third of all divorce filings included the word Facebook. Now, I don't know if you realize that or not, and I'm not trying to create an evil called Facebook, because let me be real clear about this for everybody who's in here. I like social media. I do. I got no problem with it when used properly. I got no problem with Facebook. I think they've gotten a little too big for your britches, and sometimes Zuckerberg acts stupid. But other than that, you know, you could say that about the people who create Tide at Procter & Gamble. I mean, you could say that about any product you buy. The reality is that it has a very real effect on our relationships. And let me tell you how something like this starts out, okay? Because I don't think that Facebook is inherently evil, but let me tell you how this starts. Oh, I wonder what my old high school girlfriend's up to. And you search, and you look. Hey, I think I'll message her or him and see what they're up to. And before you know it, you've gone from platonic, non-evil, just catching up to semi-deep to whoosh. And before you know it, now you've got a third of all divorce filings, including this word. We have challenges, I know, at Pleasant Valley, and I know that this is present in a lot of different churches. We have severe challenges, in particular with young married couples who have problems in their marriages because of social media. It's happening continually, and it is happening more and more and more. And I'm not even getting into the Ashley Madison data breach today, okay? I'm going to tell you what we learned from that in 2 weeks if you're interested. So go on and drive back in that food coma after you eat all that turkey, and I'll share with you some real stuff from that data breach. But the reality is this does have an impact. Let's talk about a few more impacts of things that occur as a result of the pace of social media. Now, I promise you I researched this. I promise you I grabbed actual quotes and read through all of this, but the reality is this is about a year out of date. Okay, so I'll show you what I was telling people about a year ago. There was a great article that came out with some research that was being done in China. These are some of the results. The brains of internet addicts tend to look like brains of drug and alcohol addicts. Now, internet addicts meaning, now this is going to bother some of you, the definition is use of the internet for at least 6.5 hours a day. Now, some of you, like me, went, ooh, well then I guess I am one. Because I have to use, for the work that I do, I have to be on the internet usually 9 to 12 hours a day. Just depends. I'm connected all the time, it feels like. In a study published in January of 2014, Chinese researchers found something that they called abnormal white matter, which, you know, they said were essentially extra nerve cells built for speed in the areas charged with attention, control, executive function, all of the things that are designed to throttle us. Now we're replacing with things that cause us to go faster and faster and faster. Pediatrics noted the rise of this new phenomenon called Facebook depression. It explained that the intensity of the online world may trigger depression. You think? I mean, here's the reality. You don't have to look too far. One of these presentations that I gave about a year ago was just shortly after a girl in Georgia who was 13 years old took her life because of cyberbullying. And we actually read through some of the posts that she made. Some of them are fairly graphic, so I didn't show them today. But the reality is that this does have an impact on all of us. We want to label it as a young person problem. It is not. It is an every generation problem. The fastest growing group on Facebook is 55-year-old and up. Facebook's no longer cool with the younger crowd, okay? Let me be clear about that. They've got a Facebook account, they don't use it. For them, it's all Snapchat or Instagram, okay? Facebook ceased to be cool. Don't be offended here, but it's the reality. We can track it back to a point in time. When grandma started getting on Facebook, it was no longer cool. Okay? And I don't mean that against grandmas, but that's just when we tracked it. We were able to see when that age range flipped, then all of the young, hip, dark wash jean crowd went to some of these other outlets. Now, here's the reality. Facebook loves you. They love those who are older getting on there. You know why? Because you got money. The dark wash jean crowd doesn't have money. Okay? And there's a hilarious video on supporting millennials that you need to watch, and I'm sure Chad probably has posted it. Anyway, the American Academy of Pediatrics now recommends that doctors should work digital usage questions into every annual checkup. And you will see this. You will start seeing this with pediatricians more and more and more and more, because the reality is that it has an impact. And we're all affected. We've got to learn to live with it. But I think that the root of a lot of our problems are not with the younger crowd. Okay, I'm just tossing one out there for the teens and the younger folks. I don't think it's all their fault, because they learned this behavior somewhere. And usually it's from us. And I'm not going too deep into it, but you watch social media over the last 5 days, it's no wonder that they're the way they are. Look at some of the garbage we've posted. It is shocking. So let's take just a moment and make sure that we all have this common ground of terms here, okay? Help me out. Name that social media. Just call it right out. It's okay. We haven't had communion, so it's okay to just holler it out. What is this social media? Very good. Facebook. How about this? Wrong. It is not Twitter. And yes, Tumblr. It is Tumblr. Everyone sees a T. Oh, it's got to be Twitter. No, it's not Twitter. It's Tumblr. Okay? Some of you are sitting, what is this? Face and Tumble and all this stuff. Are we playing Twister? No. But that is Tumblr. How about this? Google Plus, which everyone thought was going to be the Facebook killer. It is not. It's a lot more niche and technical and professional now. How about this? Really? You're a year and a half out of date if you're not on Peach, okay? By the way, I was on Peach about 18 months ago. And it is specific to an app on your phone. You're not, who is anyone in here other than me on Peach? No? Okay. Well, let me take a couple of years step back and we'll start talking a little bit more. How about this? Everyone knows this, right? Yeah, Instagram. This is a logo, a new logo for them, by the way. But that is the current logo for Instagram. How about this? Everyone is all fired up about Snapchat. Incidentally, so you know, and I can point you to the court documents, the owners of Snapchat sued each other, by the way, years ago. Well, it's been about, 2 years ago, maybe 20 months ago, I can't remember. When I first read some of the documents from the court case, it finally came out, the thing that most of us had assumed. Because the whole premise of Snapchat was, hey, take a picture, send it to someone. Once they view it, it goes away. Right? Yeah, that's what you think. All it does is renames the file away from JPEG, and it's still there, okay? But it looks like it's gone. And, you know, incidentally, they had a data breach about 14 months ago, I believe. If they get rid of all the data, what's there to breach? So guess what? It's still there. All that stuff that you've put out on Snapchat is still there. But interestingly enough, in that court case, it came out by one of the creators of Snapchat that it was created as a college sexting application to encourage females to send nude pictures of themselves, and then they would think that they just went away, when in fact they didn't. So how about this? Now you can say it. Twitter. Yes, that is Twitter. Let's see. I'm sorry, Chad, I promise I'm clicking. Okay, this is a big new one. Anyone on Path? Anyone heard of Path? Path is one that you're going to see more and more celebrities getting on. Path's whole premise is friend lists are too long. And if you really want to get back to being social with the people you are closest with, you use Path. It is not ad-supported as of yet. I was at a conference. I'm going to say this, and you're going to think I'm cool, but I'm really not that cool. I was at a conference last year and actually got to meet Ashton Kutcher, okay, which was weird for me because I was expecting to meet Kelso, but he was actually very, very smart. And he is on PATH, and he was telling me about how he announced, you know, they were expecting a child at the time, and how he announced to some of his friends, and he said, it's for my closest friends. I don't mess with, you know, and this is a guy who has, may still have, but at one time he had the largest following of Twitter accounts. He was being followed by more people on Twitter than anyone else in the world, and he's choosing this social network to actually interact with his closest friends on. So, how about this? Oh, come on, professional people. LinkedIn. Yes, LinkedIn. Thank you very much. And if any of you are on this, shame on you. And Danny's going to extend the invitation song a little later today. Tinder. I'm not even going to ask if you're on Tinder because you shouldn't brag about it. Tinder is basically a hookup app, okay? And for those of you who are not into that nomenclature, if you want to have, let me go a little King James. If you want to have carnal relations, you know, then Tinder is your app, okay? Because basically it is geofenced. It is designed to tell you who is near you looking for someone to, you know, we'll say connect with. So anyway, makes sense? Everybody is on all of these, I'm sure. So let me just share with you a few things that have happened online, and I think I'm actually close to time, so let me stay on pace. Wall Street Journal in 2014 ran a great, huge article called Why We Are So Rude Online. Now, I didn't intentionally go back and pull old information, but it is still appropriate and still accurate. If anything, it's only gotten exacerbated, especially through the election year. And here are some of the things that they found. Social media, we say things we'd never say face-to-face. Are you shocked by that? Not me. But some people think, well, really? I've been surprised at how many people were surprised by some of the research that comes out. We're less inhibited online because we don't have to see the face of the person we're addressing. Now, if you are on, and there was a time when Facebook had a character limit, I really wish they would go back to it. Because pretty much for me, if I scroll through my timeline and I see anyone start a post with, I don't normally post things like this online, but you're dead to me. I scroll right by you. Because I know what's coming. You're going to rant about something, and I don't care. Okay? And I just skip right on through it. You got to understand, we have become very, very uninhibited online. But I think that social media has kind of become our own personal platform. Now, there's a lot of good that can go on with social media, and I'm going to tell you, from an advertising standpoint, it's unbeatable. The average internet ad has a 0.006% click-through rate. It's abysmal. Facebook works great, especially for things that we call retargeting ads. When you go out to Zappos.com and you look at those shoes, and then those shoes follow you across the internet for 2 weeks, oh yeah, that it works great for that. But let me tell you about our personal platform. Here are some things we've all got to remember about social media. First thing is, you're the only one that cares that much about what you're posting. I'm going to say it again, because for some reason people don't get it. You are the only one that honestly cares that much about what you're posting. And for some reason, we think when we're typing it up, yeah, this will show them. And we're, you know, and we do, we do it so, it's ridiculous, the behavior we have. I have typed it up and sat there and said, well, I've already got 3 likes. Well, I'm up to 7 likes. And we just watch the likes because for some reason that justifies what we're saying. Remember, folks, you are the only one who really cares that much. Most posts you put out there are to brag. Okay, can I just say it? But you justify it as, oh, how cute. I don't care what your kids wore for Halloween. I really don't. I don't care how well your family coordinated for Halloween. I don't care. And in the words of a guy I grew up with who has relatives in this church, a guy named Todd Gillum, he would vex me every now and then because I would say something and he'd say, are you bragging or complaining? And I'm like, well, there's no good answer to that. Now look back through some of your posts. Were you bragging or complaining? Because odds are it was one of the two. And sadly, we fill up timelines with this stuff. Like we think people care. But all we're doing is we're tickling our brag bone when we do it. And some of you are nodding. Some of you are saying, oh, that's just not right. But you know it's right. I mean, somewhere deep down, you know that it's right. And here's what's sad to me. Church member posts tend to be the meanest. And this is not Hodges' idea. This is research done by Facebook, tying it back to people who claim to be Christians. They are the meanest, most spiteful, most demonizing posts that are out there. And all I can think is that there is a God who is weeping in heaven over some of the things that we put out. And if you want just a, you know, what I would call a hallmark period of the lowest of the low, you look at the last 5 days of social media. It's awful. And I honestly, I don't care who you voted for. I don't care. Put the election aside. I'm not going to, I normally don't put political posts out here. No, I'm not going to do that. I'm just telling you, you look at what has been put out there. And you will see what the Wall Street Journal found 2 years ago is correct in spades right now. And it's bothersome. So let's take a minute. Let's see what this has done to us just from a friendship standpoint. And I'm going to really have to race through some of this. So if you would, there should be something in front of you, or maybe you have something with you. Grab something to write with. Please don't defy me. I'm going to watch you, and I'm going to make sure you do this. Get something to write with. And I want you to do an exercise for me, okay? I want you to just start listing the names of your closest friends. First name only, okay? And no cheating, spouses. Don't look over. Don't shoulder surf. Just write down the first name of your closest friends. It's okay. I'm not going anywhere. You can look at the paper while you write. Write down the first name of your closest friends. Now, incidentally, here are the rules. Don't put your spouse, okay? I'm knocking that one off right now. Don't put your spouse. Do not put your dog, you dog lovers. Do not put your cat, you demonic lovers of Egyptian lore. No, you need to just put the first names of your closest friends. And just take a few seconds to do that while I tell you a couple of things that I want to frame this up as, because, you know, when we talk about social media, we got to talk about the effect on friendship. And I'm going to give you some things that I've learned from some of the wisdom literature in the Bible, so don't think that this is original to me, okay? I'm going to give Solomon credit on this. List your closest friends, and I want you to understand that I can tell you wholeheartedly, you show me your friends, and I'll show you your future. Show me your friends, I promise you, I can show you your future. I have tried to drive this nail into the head of my son who is in college multiple times. I've tried to drive this into my kids. I've tried to drive this into people I know, and people have tried to drive it into me. This is the thing our mamas always told us that we didn't really want to believe, but now that we're older, we understand it, right? And we get it. Now, there's another truth that I have learned, and that is that we are the average of our five closest friends. Now, you think about that, okay? And this is not scientific. I've just found this to hold fairly true. Of your five closest friends, you're probably the average. You may not be the wealthiest. You may not be the least wealthy. You're probably somewhere in between. Of the five people you're closest to, if two or three of them abuse alcohol, odds are you may abuse alcohol. I mean, this goes in all facets of life. So keep those two truths in mind. Show me your friends, and I'll show you your future. And you typically are the average of your five closest friends. And while you think about that, I want to share with you a passage out of Proverbs 17:17 out of the FBV, okay? A friend is someone you may or may not know who accepts your friend requests on Facebook. This person is born to like and comment on your posts to make you feel good about yourself and would never disagree openly in your timeline. It's Proverbs 17:17 in the Facebook version. Now, some of you are looking like, is that really in there? No. Let me show you the real version, okay? A friend loves when. Oh, yeah. Let's mumble that again. A friend loves when. At all times. And a brother is born for adversity. Now, it is amazing to me how appropriate the Bible is today. When we deal with social media and when we are dealing with people that we are calling friends, it is amazing to me how completely appropriate and relevant it is today. So I'm going to ask you to make a commitment this morning, and then we're going to get to your list. I'm going to ask you to make a commitment. And this is the commitment. I want to ask you to commit. I will develop my friendships face-to-face, not just thumb-to-thumb. Now you think about that. I will develop my friendships face-to-face and not just thumb-to-thumb, because that is what God did for us. He is the one that in John says the Word became flesh, and as Eugene Peters says, moved into our neighborhood. The Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. I think even today, if Christ had not come yet and He came today, I don't think that He would have shown up on social media with a big splash. He probably would have been on there, but He would not have used that as His channel. He still would have come close and made real, authentic, face-to-face friendships. That is why the Word became flesh. He could have very easily sent down a holy picture and said, here is my picture, here is my book, learn it. He could have done it, but He didn't. He decided to come down here and befriend us and walk with humanity. So, with that, I want to introduce you to one of our two commercial breaks this morning. Okay, this is one of my favorite commercials that came out in 2014. That was a fun year because it had a lot of good Super Bowl commercials, but this one, to me, was better than anything that ran in the Super Bowl. It's an ad for the Irish beer maker Guinness. And just take a look and watch and see what happens. That's not the kind of friendship you develop just online, is it? That's a friendship that is there, it is present. Let me race through this because I'm running out of time fast. So 26 years ago, when I started work, okay, I had graduated college. 26 years ago, I started work, and at that time, the average American had 7 close friends. If you ask somebody to list, just like I ask you, to list your closest friends, they would list on average about 7 people. Today, the average American has 2 close friends. This is something that has declined just in my adult lifetime down to 2. Here's the weird thing about that. Our friend lists are getting longer, but our actual friendships are getting smaller. So there is an effect. There's an effect of authentic relationship, and it's one of the things that, in all honesty, we've got to pay attention to. So let me give you the 3 reasons I see for declining friendships, and I'm just going to race through these for the interest of time. And I'm going backward, 3, 2, 1, okay? To me, the third one is increasing work hours. We are connected all the time. Now, those of you who knew me when I was a child, when we had the old auditorium over here, you remember my dad, and he wore this big black thing on his belt. You remember that? It was called a what? Yeah, it's called a pager, and that was back before they had vibrate function. So at any given service, whether Leon or whoever was preaching, you would hear 138 call Memorial, and he's getting up and going to find a phone. And I remember thinking when I was a kid, I'm never having a job like that. Well, guess what? I work all the time, and you do too. 9:15 at night, I pull out my phone. I'm kind of glancing through it. Oh, I got an email. Well, I'll just answer that. And then 30 minutes later, I look up, and I realize, oh, wait a minute. I've just lost part of my night. Second thing is mobility rates. We are moving every 5 to 7 years, and if you're in your 20s or 30s, you move every 2 to 3 years. And I know what you say because I've heard you said it. Well, we're only going to be here a little while, so I don't know that it would make sense to invest the time. So mobility rates are having a great effect on this. And number one, in my opinion, is the connected life. This explosion of social media that we're experiencing, I think we are obsessed. We've become very obsessed with our online personas. Years ago, would you have ever called someone and said, hey, I'm eating oatmeal this morning? Would you? I've made a picture of it. As soon as I get it developed, I'll send it to you. But now we snap a picture with the butter melting just so perfectly, and we post it. Guess what I ate this morning? We're making pictures of our lattes. We're making pictures of everything we put in our mouth. And it goes back to, we're bragging about it. Look what I made. Look at these cute cookies. Look at the frosting on my kid's nose. You know, all of that stuff. I mean, we've become very obsessed with our online personas, and here's the challenge. Social media really should be a supplement. It should never be a replacement for real friendship. When it gets down to it, it's got to be a supplement. And if it's anything other than that, then it's not how it was designed. It's not how it should be used, which leads me to my second great commercial that I absolutely loved, and I just want you to take a look at. Just watch this. I know you've seen it.
Instead of mailing everyone my vacation photos, I'm saving a ton of time by posting them to my wall.
Ooh, I like that one.
It's so quick. It's just like my car insurance. I save 15% in just 15 minutes.
I saved more than that in half the time.
I'd unfriend you.
That's not how it works. That's not how any of this works.
15 minutes for a quote.
Isn't that great?
Isn't how it works anymore.
I love Beatrice. Beatrice is great. I'm telling you, I love the ceremony of it. I unfriend you. I mean, that's just, if we would do that face to face, we'd clear up a lot of problems. Oh, really? Well, I unfriend you. Folks, let's face it. That's not how any of this was designed to work. When we use it as the primary mechanism of our friendships, it's not how it was designed. It's not how it was supposed to work. So let me give you two challenges that I think exist with life-changing friendships. And I'll race through these because I know I got like 2 minutes, okay? The first is take the challenge to be present. Please, take the challenge to be present. And remember our commitment. I will develop my friendships face-to-face, not just thumb-to-thumb. And remember that the Word did become flesh and dwelt among us. Make sure that we take the challenge to be present. And the second thing is be transparent. That's the challenge with social media today, because we only put the good stuff out there. People don't get to know any of our flaws. And when I say be transparent, it makes me think about the fastest growing phobia in the U.S., which is talking on the phone. And this is measured. And you know this to be true. I have millennial kids. They don't want to talk on the phone. My daughter has gone into sales. She doesn't want to talk on the phone. I'm like, are you kidding me? You're selling. Pick up the phone, call the person. It eliminates so much hassle. But they don't want to talk on the phone. In fact, you've done it. I know you've done it. You get a call and you do this. I don't know if I want to talk to them or not. Let me just send it to voicemail. And then a little later, you listen to the voicemail and say, okay, I'm going to create a perfectly crafted text to send back to them to answer their question. And you do it just perfectly. Folks, we got to be transparent. We got to show some of our flaws. We've got to be willing to show the things that we have when we have authentic authentic friendships. And I'll leave you with this. We may impress people with our strengths, but we connect with people through our weaknesses. When we spend most of our online lives just trying to impress, we really aren't connecting. Connection comes through our weaknesses. It comes through that type of interaction. So I hope like anything, that you don't think I've just bashed social media. That wasn't the intent. I love it, but it's got to be used correctly, and we've got to train our kids how to use it. And a lot of the problems we have is because they are seeing the way we act on it. So maybe we need to take the lesson ourselves to start. Let's have a prayer, and then we'll be done. God, thank you so much for the blessing of living in this time right now. Father, help us to be careful and seek your guidance for how we use the blessings you've given us. And help us, Father, to control ourselves. And Father, most importantly, help us to teach. Help us to teach our kids how to use this properly. And Father, help us, even when we may not want to, help us to invest the time to learn how to properly use these gifts. Father, we love you and we praise you and we thank you through Jesus. Amen.